Right, so this is my current working version 3 tricopter. It's been okay, it flies okay, it depends on weather conditions and a lot of other different factors, but essentially it flies okay. Not great yet, but I'm still learning about the KK2 board on it, which hopefully is getting there. I'm sort of happy with the current settings, but they certainly need, it flies okay, stable enough, but it just needs enhancing a little bit with those, so I'm sort of learning about the KK settings as I go along. Haven't had a chance to experiment with them too much because I've needed it to work, so I'm just sticking with what I know on it at the moment. Some of the parts I keep modifying, the GoPro camera mount at the bottom, wired mount, I keep just enhancing it a little bit, and even the latest one I'm using isn't currently the one that I have designed, so I've already got another better design for that. The reason this thing crashed was a, where is it, here we go, was a wet ESC. This just had a heat sink on and then it was heat shrink wrapped as well, and you can see, I've lost it now, you can see it's slightly burnt out on those little FET boards, those first three of them from right to left. I'll have some damage, specifically that end one, you actually see it's browned up, but when I got back to dry land, I plugged this in. I dried the motor up as best I could. Plugged this back in, didn't really dry it enough, and it went up in a puff of that telltale smoke and stank, and it still does stink actually. So I'm going to strip out the wires of this. I might need them for something else, always handy to have, and then I can get rid of that. However, because of that, this thing failed, had no spare parts, so this time I've waterproofed all the ESCs. I've had to take the heat sink off, which I'm a little bit worried about for dissipating the heat on these. I'm hoping, because they're exposed to the elements like they are, that I'm hoping the heat dissipation is still going to be okay, and these things, I don't really put that much battery power through them. It's a bit of a cruising machine rather than one that rips, so I'm hoping, fingers crossed, that these things aren't going to overheat. They do have liquid tape on them all now to protect them from the elements. I was really unfortunate because, let me get this, the way I had the rear, all of these ESCs are mounted on the top. However, at the rear, I had actually had this one mounted on the side for whatever reason. And it was the part that just the tail dipped in the water, and the water actually got in the, between the heat shrink and stuck in there. If the heat shrink wasn't on, it would have probably run off and I'd have been okay, but it shorted those out. I think, I'm not sure why it dropped into the water. On my part, there was just a lack of power to pull it back up. I had a couple of close calls to the water and it sort of tried to pull it in from the draft, but I had enough power to pull out, but on that final time it just kept sinking, not much I could do. I suspect the battery I was using, well, I know for a fact the battery I was using wasn't the best in the world. One of my older ones, it was part late in the day. I thought I'd put one last couple of batteries through, and they were the older ones, which I wouldn't normally use. I thought they were okay. I would have been okay for a flight at least. It lacked the power and dropped the tail in. Nothing I could do about it. I had no spare parts, so sadly that cut my flying short. Quite a few lessons learned from it though, and hopefully I've improved this to have another go at it. This time I'm going to Lake Coniston, I hope. It's a bit of a smaller lake, but close to Windermere. And hopefully I can get some better footage, and hopefully the weather will be better. The weather was atrocious. It was absolutely howling, the wind, for the most part. It dropped now and then, you get like a still couple of moments, but by the time you got it in the air, it was blowing a gale again. It was pouring down with rain, and a lot of spray from the actual kayak as well was going over all the electronics, so I'm surprised it lasted as long as it did. However, rather than take any spare parts, as you can probably see on the side here, let me turn it around so it's the same way. This is a version 3 also, get it out the way. That is a version 3, but 50mm have been cut off all of the legs. I just think, I don't know where I got the size of this. I can't remember the actual length of these booms. I couldn't measure them, I guess, but it's sort of irrelevant for now whilst I'm playing around with a few factors on it. but I have shortened these by 50 millimeters, easier to transport, and I'm hoping it reduces the vibrations on it. Not that I had many on there now I've put the carbon boom on and redone the tail mechanism. My version 3 seemed a lot better, and I've messed around with the KK settings as well, so those three factors have probably helped dampen down a lot of the oscillations I was getting with the tail. This one is generally identical. It's got a few enhancements on it. It's got a different video transmitter on it, a Fat Shark on there, 250 milliwatt. That aerial that's currently on there is going to be swapped out. I just want to check the range of that. It may stay on, I'm not sure. I only want something that can do maybe a kilometer, 1.5 kilometers maximum. The motors are pretty much all the same. They're off an old crashed one, and that one, even now, it sounds a little bit. I'll probably swap that out. I'm going to put it in the air, see what sort of vibrations and noises I get, but that rear one certainly sounds dodgy. And all these with numbers on are because they've come off previous flying machines. That doesn't seem so bad, neither does that one, but that tail one certainly vibrates a lot. The wiring needs to be tidied up a little bit. It's slightly oversized, a lot of the wiring, because if this thing turns out to fly rubbish compared to its larger friend over there, then I will just increase the sizes of all this. It won't be a big job to swap out those booms. Ideally, I would like the wooden boom on the rear, but I don't have time to test the wooden one for now, so I'm just sticking with what I know works, and that's the carbon one. I just fancy when I tighten this up, problem with PLA is you tighten it, then the next day it kind of pulls through the nut and bolts, it all softens up and you have to retighten everything and becomes a bit of a pain. So when they're new it's okay, but as they get older and worn, the PLA tends to break down a little bit. So I think eventually I need some, just a better system of tightening it. There's a lot of hardware on there as regards nuts and bolts. I'd like to reduce the amount of hardware I've got on there and hopefully replace those with zip ties. So I need to sit down and just work out a better design of how it all goes together. For now it works, that's all I want, something that works. I wanted something initially to test, which I had, and I liked it, so I've developed it a little bit, but I need to sit down properly and just work out what goes where, and just a better layout really. The KK board itself, I don't like the case it comes with. That's not mine, it's something I downloaded from someone else on Thingiverse, and it works, but again, I don't like it. These hexagonal upstands are too big. The other one has smaller ones on, which are about 6mm, 10mm, something like that. These are more like 15, and they're just too high. Seems really exposed, the KK board. The camera, that's identical to the other one, same Sony HAD. Pretty good, really cheap, and come from China. I've waterproofed that on both of them, as you can see. I have not waterproofed the video transmitter, and that might be a bad thing, but that's brand new. I don't want to get a load of that liquid tape splattered all over it for now, because this will not be staying on here. I may do that one because that's an old video transmitter. I should really waterproof that, but I can't be bothered to take it apart for now. But yeah, I should really do that one. And I will use that as a outdoor, in the wet, snow kind of video transmitter from now on. But that one, I'm going to leave it as it is. It's running on the same Spectrum gear, mainly because I can transport my Spectrum. We got a handset around, it's only a DX7, something like that. So I don't mind if it gets roughed up and beaten up so much. So this is all so I can take it out in the field and not worry about damaging things or crashing it or losing it or dipping it in the water. So that's the plan with these ones. I'm sure it'd be a lot easier to go and throw my TBS Discovery up in the air and not have a care in the world, but it only takes that one crash and you have lost a very nice TBS Discovery. So that's the reason for these. I can afford to fly them in places I wouldn't normally fly them. That's about it with these. I need, obviously the water bottles are currently not on. Those worked really well. I was amazed how far it sat out the water. It was hilarious. When it went in, I thought, uh-oh, will it float? And it more than floated. It hardly touched the water at all. Camera tray was slightly in the water. I think the battery sat in the water. For the most part, it worked, and I got my need a better way of tethering my camera. I had my GoPro tethered to one of the water bottles with some cotton. I'm hoping the cotton, I'm going to upgrade that to something. I need some kind of proper tether on there. It was just a last minute do or die, kind of tie it on there. It was a real botch job, but fortunately I got my camera back and I got some footage back. But hopefully this next time, armed with two of them and possibly a third H-copter as well, I'm hoping for some better action, and I'm certainly hoping for some better weather. Fingers crossed.